you have to be a working manager and a leader at the same time. Your team will only do as you do and not as you say. So it's very important to set the right example.
People who are in the leadership sector should be able to walk the talk. You cannot preach about sustainability without making sacrifices, small sacrifices in your lifestyle. That's the key. It will redound to the individual behavior of the people preaching and of the people actually following.
Authentic community. By focusing on that particular core value, a lot of these Gen Zs and millennials can be themselves. They don't have to pretend anymore. As we prioritize...
Contact tracing czar Benjamin Magalong submits his irrevocable resignation to the palace. He says pandemic authorities in the Philippines should practice leadership by example.
The Philippines lifts its travel ban on countries with cases of new COVID-19 variants.
The University of the Philippines welcomes the government's firing of a top intelligence official behind the publication of an erroneous list of alleged communist rebels. But progressive lawmakers say this is not enough.
And the U.S. reaffirms its long-standing support to Taiwan amid rising tensions between the self-ruled island and China.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crow.
And I'm Denise Dinsai.
You're watching Top Story. Baguio City Mayor Benjamin Magalong says his resignation as contact tracing czar is irrevocable after Malacañang quickly rejected it. Magalong volunteered to quit following an intense backlash for attending a party where health protocols were ignored. He said pandemic response authorities should practice leadership by example. But Malacañang asserts Magalong continues to enjoy the trust and confidence of the country's COVID-19 task force. Vaccine czar Carlito Galvez Jr. also says Magalong will be a huge loss to the country's pandemic response team.
Napakasakit sa amin nung pinasangan niya sa akin yung kanyang resignation paper, pero hindi po namin matatanggap dahil kasi napakalaki po ng ginawa po ni Benji Magalong sa amin. Tingnan lang po natin yung ulterior motive po na talagang yung magandang motive po ni Sir Benji na why he is there and we give him the benefit of doubt sana.
For testing czar Vince Dizon, the public should not judge Magalong based on the Baguio party incident alone.
It just shows the kind of person Mayor Benji is. And napaka-rare breed of public servant ni Mayor Benji. Bihirang-bihira ang isang nagsiservisyo publiko na unang-una humble enough to admit na nagkulang siya at nagkamali siya.
Metro Manila and the entire Cordillera Administrative Region will be under General Community Quarantine, or GCQ, next month. Metro Manila has been under GCQ since June 2020, excluding its return to a stricter lockdown in August. As for the Cordillera Administrative Region, its lockdown level will be upgraded in February following a spike in cases there and the threat of new COVID-19 variants. Also under GCQ next month are Batangas, Tacloban City, Davao City, Davao del Norte, Lanao del Sur, and Iligan City. The rest of the country will be under a more relaxed MGCQ. As of Friday, the Philippines has over 35,000 active coronavirus cases, the highest since November last year. 1,800 of them were recorded on Friday, raising the country's overall tally to more than 521,000. The death toll climbed to 10,600. 475,765 patients, meanwhile, have recovered from the illness.
The Philippines lifts its travel ban on countries with cases of new COVID-19 variants. All returning Filipinos and foreigners will be allowed to enter the Philippines starting February 1st. They must have a pre-booked quarantine hotel reservation and will need to complete a 14-day quarantine. They must also undergo testing on the sixth day of the quarantine. For a former special advisor to Manila's COVID-19 task force, the lifting of the ban may hurt the country's pandemic response.
We're looking at the global updates from Europe and the US and other countries, and you can see there's a surge right now. Now, if we are not sure about this and our healthcare system will be strained, I think we need to be very careful. I think they have to monitor this on a weekly basis and then try to impose again travel bans just in case there will be surges in the NCR.
The Philippines earlier imposed a ban on arrivals from dozens of countries with reported cases of the new COVID-19 variants. The ban covered travelers from the UK, the US, China, Brazil, and South Africa.
Overseas, Britain adds the United Arab Emirates to a list of countries where travel to the European country is prohibited. This in a major attempt by the UK to stop the spread of a COVID-19 variant found in South Africa. Here's the full story.
Britain is banning direct passenger flights to and from the United Arab Emirates starting from Friday. This will shut down the world's busiest international airline route from Dubai to London. Data over the month of January showed over 190,000 scheduled seats. On top of the UAE, the UK is also banning flights from Burundi and Rwanda, all in a bid to stop the spread of a coronavirus variant first found in South Africa. Transport Minister Grant Shapps said on Thursday via Twitter, people who have been in or transited through those countries will be denied entry, except British, Irish and third country nationals with residence. The news also delivers a blow to countries that use the UAE for transit. Emirates and Etihad normally carry large number of passengers connecting to destinations like Australia, meaning cancelling those flights will have far-reaching implications. In response, the Australian government said it will add more charter flights from Britain if needed.
Vietnam's coronavirus outbreak spreads to the capital, Hanoi, as authorities report 9 new cases. A 27-floor apartment where Hanoi's single case lives has been locked down, with residents told to stay at home. The outbreak started Thursday when 83 cases were confirmed in 2 provinces near the capital. One of them was exposed to a patient who contracted the UK COVID-19 variant. In Brazil, researchers say they discovered a couple of coronavirus patients infected with 2 different COVID-19 variants at the same time. Both were found with the P.2 variant, found in Rio de Janeiro, and a second variant of the virus. The researchers fear co-infections like this could lead to a faster emergence of new COVID-19 variants. U.S. vaccine maker Novavax, meanwhile, says its COVID-19 vaccine is nearly 90% effective against the coronavirus based on clinical trials in Britain. Results also show it being nearly 80% effective against the UK variant, while a separate trial shows up to 60% effectiveness against the variant from South Africa.
Europe's battle to secure COVID-19 vaccine intensifies. As this report tells us, the European Union is threatening to use legal means and even block exports to ensure enough vaccine supply.
Europe stepped up its fight to secure COVID-19 vaccines on Thursday, warning drug companies such as AstraZeneca it would use all legal means and even block exports unless they delivered. European Council President Charles Michel said in a letter to 4 EU leaders that the bloc should explore all options at its disposal, if negotiations with companies over delayed deliveries failed. Meanwhile, Britain insisted it receive all the shots it paid for, after the European Union asked AstraZeneca to divert supplies from the UK. British Cabinet Minister Michael Gove said Thursday the UK's orders must be honoured. The EU is lagging behind ex-member Britain, as well as the United States and Israel, in rolling out the vaccine, and is now scrambling to get supplies as the West's drug-making giants slow deliveries because of production problems. Vaccination centres in Germany and France are cancelling or delaying appointments, and the EU publicly rebuked AstraZeneca for failing to deliver, even though the bloc hasn't yet approved the vaccine. AstraZeneca CEO Pascal Soriot fired back that the EU was late to strike a supply contract, leaving little time to iron out production problems at a vaccine factory run by a partner in Belgium. UK supply experienced similar glitches, he said, but they were sorted out because Britain signed a contract 3 months ago. The swiftest mass vaccination drive in history is stoking tensions across the world, as big powers buy up vaccines in bulk and poorer nations navigate a financial and diplomatic minefield to collect whatever supplies are left.
Over in the U.S., the Pentagon is evaluating a request to help in administering COVID-19 vaccines. That request came from the Federal Emergency Management Agency, or FEMA, after U.S. President Joe Biden said it is possible to administer 150 million vaccine doses in his first 100 days in office. If it pushes through, thousands of troops could be deployed to help the U.S. vaccination drive.
These types of requests, we are certainly putting through the same levels of analysis under Secretary Austin's direction that we would for any other type of allocation of soldiers. But certainly it is something that we are taking extraordinarily seriously. The Secretary has made this absolutely clear. We have to move further, we have to move faster, we have to be as bold as possible, all the while remembering that it is our utmost prerogative to protect and defend the United States at home as well as abroad.
Using the military to fight the pandemic is not new. At its peak, under former U.S. President Donald Trump, more than 47,000 National Guard troops were supporting COVID-19 operations, and about 20,000 continue to help.
The United States detects its first cases of the South Africa coronavirus variant in South Carolina. The state's health department says the two cases appear to be unrelated, and neither of the two adults had travel history that would account for their infection. The presence of the new variant is especially concerning as laboratory studies show it reduces vaccine effectiveness. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control, however, notes there is no evidence of the variant being more deadly. The arrival of the South African variant follows predictions by the CDC this month that the more transmissible UK variant could become the dominant strain in the U.S. by March.
And as the pandemic rages in the U.S., President Joe Biden takes steps to give more Americans health insurance. Biden signed an executive order reopening the nation's online health insurance marketplace for people who cannot obtain coverage through their employers. He also directed federal agencies to re-examine Trump-era policies that made it more difficult to qualify for Medicaid, the government-run health insurance program for the poor. Biden also rescinded the so-called Mexico City policy, which bans U.S. funding for international organizations that offer abortion, advocate for it, or provide abortion counseling.
There's nothing new that we're doing here other than restoring the Affordable Care Act and restoring the Medicaid to the way it was before Trump became president, which by fiat he changed, made more inaccessible, more expensive, and more difficult for people to qualify for. Second order I'm signing relates to protecting women's health at home and abroad.
In U.S. politics, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi says American lawmakers may need more security funding, citing what she calls the enemy within Congress. Details in this report.
It means that we have members of Congress who want to bring guns on the floor and have threatened violence on other members of Congress.
Chilling words from House Speaker Nancy Pelosi on Thursday, who in the wake of the deadly siege on the U.S. Capitol said lawmakers would likely need more funding for security to protect them not just from outside threats, but also potentially from their own colleagues in the House of Representatives, whom she described as, quote, the enemy within.
I do believe, and I have said this all along, that we will probably need a supplemental for more security for members when the enemy is within the House of Representatives.
What exactly did you mean when you said that the enemy is within? What exactly did you mean?
It means that we have members of Congress who want to bring guns on the floor and have threatened violence on other members of Congress.
Pelosi did not name names, but earlier in her press conference was asked about newly elected Republican Representative Marjorie Taylor Greene from Georgia, who has come under scrutiny this week for online comments she posted before taking office supporting violence against Democrats, including Pelosi. Greene is the first member of Congress to have openly expressed support for the QAnon conspiracy theory. And in a video from 2019 that resurfaced and went viral this week, is seen harassing a student who survived the shooting at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School in Parkland, Florida, the year before. Greene now sits on the House Education and Labor Committee.
What would you like to see done about her?
What I'm concerned about is the Republican leadership in the House of Representatives, who is willing to overlook, ignore those statements, assigning her to the Education Committee when she has mocked the killing of little children at Sandy Hook Elementary School, when she has mocked the killing of teenagers in high school at the Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School. What could they be thinking, or is thinking too generous a word for what they might be doing?
Greene, in a Twitter post, said some of her social media posts did not represent her views. A gun rights activist and ardent supporter of former President Donald Trump's, Greene is among those who have bristled at increased security measures, such as the installation of a metal detector at the House entrance. Last week, Republican lawmaker Andy Harris was found carrying a concealed gun while trying to enter the House floor. The Department of Homeland Security this week issued a bulletin warning of heightened threats, saying that some, quote, domestic violent extremists may feel emboldened by the Capitol rampage.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump vows to help his fellow Republicans take the majority of the lower chamber of Congress in next year's midterms. Trump made the pledge during a meeting with House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy at his Mar-a-Lago club in Palm Beach, Florida, where the former president now lives. The meeting came 3 weeks after McCarthy enraged Trump by saying that the then outgoing president bore responsibility for the January 6th Capitol riot. A statement issued by Trump's Save America Political Action Committee described Thursday's meeting between the two men as a cordial one. It added they focused on the goal of Republicans to take control of the House in the 2022 elections. McCarthy, for his part, says Trump committed to electing Republicans in the House and the Senate and criticized Democrats for impeaching a president who is now a private citizen. Up next, a top official of the Armed Forces of the Philippines takes a leave of absence in the latest on the fallout from the publication of an erroneous list of alleged communist rebels.
And the Supreme Court denies a bid by the Office of the Solicitor General to cancel next Tuesday's oral arguments on the anti-terror law. More news when we return. We'll be right back.
You have to be a working manager and a leader at the same time. Your team will only do as you do and not as you say. So it's very important to set the right example.
People who are in the leadership sector should be able to walk the talk. You cannot preach about sustainability without making sacrifices, small sacrifices in your lifestyle. That's the key. It will redound to the individual behavior of the people preaching and of the people actually following.
Authentic community. By focusing on that particular core value, a lot of these Gen Zs and millennials can be themselves. They don't have to pretend anymore. As we prioritize the voices and the feedback of our young,
back to Top Story. The Philippine Supreme Court appoints retired Associate Justice Francis Ardeleza as amicus curiae in the oral arguments on petitions against the anti-terror law. This was confirmed in a resolution dated January 26, but made public only Friday. An amicus curiae is an experienced and impartial attorney whose opinion is sought by the Supreme Court. The court, meanwhile, is yet to act on a similar bid by former Solicitor General Estelito Mendoza. In the same resolution, the High Court required the Office of the Solicitor General to comment on the manifestation and motion filed by retired Senior Associate Justice Antonio Carpio and fellow petitioners. They called out a Facebook post by a certain Antonio Parlade, which red-baited petitioners against the anti-terror law. Parlade is a military general and a spokesperson of the country's anti-communist insurgency task force. The High Court also denied the supplemental motion filed by the OSG seeking to cancel the oral arguments on the measure scheduled next Tuesday.
The Philippine Army's Deputy Chief of Staff for Civil Military Operations is taking a leave of absence over the publication of an erroneous list of alleged communist rebels. In a statement, Major General Benedict Arevalo admits the list was a mistake committed by his office. He says he is taking responsibility for their actions. Arevalo adds he does not want to influence the ongoing probe on the issue. His decision comes after Defense Secretary Delfin Lorenzana fired Deputy Chief of Staff for Intelligence Major General Alex Luna over the release of the list. Lorenzana called it an unforgivable lapse. The military earlier drew flak for posting the list that identifies students and alumni of the University of the Philippines as members of the New People's Army. The post has since been deleted. The University of the Philippines lauds Defense Secretary Delfin Lorenzana's decision to sack the military's highest-ranking intelligence officer over the publication of an erroneous list of alleged members of the New People's Army. The university says Lorenzana's move displayed professionalism and a willingness to take responsibility for and rectify grievous errors. But for the House's left-leaning Makabayan bloc, the firing is not enough. Congresswoman Franz Castro says the entire Philippine Defense Department, including its secretary, Delfin Lorenzana, should be held accountable.
As you have said, this is deeply rooted on the policy of the AFP itself. Buwagin itong NTF-ELCAC, i-defund at i-channel ito doon sa mga social services at iba pang mga pangangailangan ngayon ng ating gobyerno. Hanggat nandiyan yung policy ng ating gobyerno at syempre pinalalakas pa yan noong anti-terror law na ngayon ay pinatutupad ng buong administration. Hanggat nandiyan si President Duterte, hindi matitigil ang red tagging sa mga aktivista.
The highly criticized Facebook post by the armed forces falsely claimed that the names of the former UP students in that list joined the armed struggle and were either killed or captured by the military. Among the names in that list is Free Legal Assistance Group lawyer Rafi Aquino, who is alive and well. Actually, now joins us via Zoom for his reaction over the firing of the military's Deputy Chief of Staff for Intelligence. Attorney Aquino, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Ron, and our viewers, good afternoon.
Attorney, you appreciated the sacking of General Alex Luna, and you actually described it as a pocket of relative sanity. Now we have the J7 head taking a leave while there is an ongoing investigation. But are you among those who are saying that these are not enough?
Yes, I am, because there are critical questions that still need to be answered. Among these questions are, in the first place, what was the basis for General Luna to include us in the list? It is a frightening prospect that our military establishment continues to hold dossiers, possibly of our activities as student leaders in UP 40 years ago? Mm-hmm. Or are they monitoring Facebook posts, social media exchanges? Are we under surveillance? These are the questions that need to be answered by the security sector.
And some of us are asking the same question as well, including one of your questions, which is, why did they have to come up with the list in the first place and then publicly reveal it? Do you have any thoughts on that? Do you have any theories on why?
I really don't know. All I could do is hazard some guesses. Like, for instance, you know, in the times we are in, being tagged as a communist or a member of the NPA is like having a target pinned to your back. Mm-hmm. I am now wondering if this is in facilitation of military targeting. Are we being set up for more unpleasant consequences? Are we being identified as combatants and military targets? We want answers to these nagging questions. It is not only us, because as I said in my statement, if this could be done to us, what more? Filipinos who are not as, who do not have the same access that we did to media or to legal resources, how could we bring our story, our situation to the public consciousness? We were able to do that, but what about ordinary students, for instance, and their ordinary teachers in our campuses?
Now, despite the sacking of General Luna and an apology posted by the AFP, damage has been done. We do want to know the immediate effects of your name coming up in that list. How did that affect you? You did say you and your family feel threatened.
Yes, we did feel threatened. We do feel threatened. We are now insecure, always worried about what may come next. But more than this, myself and the other alumni in the list who were all UP student leaders 40 years ago worry about what this portends for the protest movement in general. Because the effect of all of this is just to chill you into silence. And that is no way to live. Freedom of expression is foundational to democracy. And this must end, this practice of red tagging. It chills us into silence.
Are you pushing through with a plan to file charges against those responsible for the publication of this list?
We are in consultation with our lawyers, and there is a whole array of legal remedies that are being considered. Not really to as a way of getting back to individuals who may be at fault here, but really to help the leadership of the military and the Department of National Defense, especially the adult in the room, Secretary Lorenzana, instill the principles that we've all expect from our soldiers: accountability and professionalism. We'd like to help in reforming that.
After going through this experience, and as you said, you still feeling the repercussions of this, Senator Panfilo Lacson has raised the idea of possibly making red tagging a criminal act. Are you in favor of that?
Yes, I am. I am in favor of that. But let me just add to that. Whether there is a law or not criminalizing red tagging, the fact is, in international humanitarian law, red tagging is proscribed because it blurs the distinction between combatants and civilians. The purpose of international humanitarian law is to minimize the danger of non-combatants emerging from an armed conflict. So both parties to the conflict must observe the distinction between combatants and non-combatants. Red tagging totally ignores that distinction. So law or not, red tagging is unlawful.
Attorney Rafi Aquino of the Free Legal Assistance Group, thank you very much for talking to us.
Salamat po.
The Philippine Senate must compel government agencies to cooperate with its probe into unresolved killings under the Duterte administration. That's according to Carlos Conde of the Human Rights Watch. He says the probe will need all the help it can get, including gaining access to records related to the more than 6,000 people killed during police operations between 2016 and 2019.
Basically, we want the hearing to be much more independent, much more expansive, much more, I think, serious in really going deep into the complicity of the PNP here, because let's not forget that the PNP itself has admitted killing more than now 6,000 people during police operations. And again, I keep repeating this, that deaths need to be investigated. In fact, the police conduct in those killings need to be really investigated properly, not just by the Senate, but several other agencies of government.
The Philippine Commission on Human Rights expresses hopes the Senate will make policy recommendations to improve the police force.
Like example, they don't use any body cam, which has always been our recommendation from the start. They should be able to restrain themselves from actually using immediate force. The human rights approach should be incorporated in their curriculum. Mm-hmm. So these are just a few of our recommendations, and we've actually communicated with them a long time ago.
Progressive groups continue to demand justice for the 9 indigenous leaders killed by security forces in Capiz and Iloilo provinces last month. Demonstrators held simultaneous protests Friday in front of the Quezon City offices of the National Commission on Indigenous Peoples and Interior Department. Protesters insist both agencies failed to hold the police accountable. The group Katibu reiterates the victims were massacred.
Hindi lang pagmamasaker sa tumandok ang ginawa nito, kundi ang paglapastangan mismo sa katauhan ng mga katutubong tumandok na kung saan naglabas pa ng isang direktiba na ang mga tumandok ay hindi tunay na mga tao na kumakatawan sa tumandok.
Authorities earlier said they were serving search warrants for illegal possession of firearms during last month's operations when their targets fought back. The families of the slain indigenous leaders suspect the weapons were planted by government forces.
The Philippine Interagency COVID-19 Task Force has recommended the unhampered passage of hogs from Visayas and Mindanao to prevent a pig shortage, which has pushed up pork prices in Luzon. This follows the proposal of the Agriculture Department to designate the Nautical Highway from Luzon and Mindanao and the Maharlika Highway in Luzon as special hog lanes. Pork prices have reached a high of 400 pesos per kilo in some Metro Manila markets as the African swine fever forced authorities to cull thousands of pigs in Luzon. Malacañang says a price cap that will curb pork prices is forthcoming. Meanwhile, the Agriculture Department has petitioned the lowering of tariff for imported pork for 1 year. The petition is now with the Tariff Commission and is due for public hearing on February 4. But local hog raisers expressed their disappointment over the move, which they say favors importers and meat processors.
Philippine shares fall back to the 6,600 level following the announcement of new quarantine classifications for February. The local market also posted its third weekly drop for the year. More from Michelle Ong.
Philippine shares took another bad tumble Friday, losing 6% for this week. A week when government released weaker-than-expected GDP data and announced stricter GCQ restrictions will remain in areas like Metro Manila through February.
We saw it back in March, just right after the crash. After that burst of optimism, it will come back down as investors' expectations come back to reality. Investors overexcited and over-optimistic, and then the reality just kicks them in the butt.
For the day, the PSE index dropped 239 points back to the 6,600 level as net foreign outflows, now on its 11th day, deepened. In corporate stories, AC Energy lists nearly 2.3 billion common shares from its stock rights offer. The ASUN shares were offered at 2 pesos and 37 centavos apiece. It closed at 6.40 in Friday trade. The energy unit of Ayala raised 5.4 billion pesos of fresh capital from the exercise. In other news, Bloomberg reports Lucky Me maker Mon Nissin is looking at a possible initial public offering in Manila that could raise as much as $1 billion. Deliberations are reportedly at early stages. The snack food giant has been mulling a share sale as early as 2015. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Central Bank sees a potential uptick in inflation for the month of January. The BSP sees inflation for the month settling between 3.3 to 4.1%. This means the final inflation print could be higher than the 3.5% recorded in December 2020, which itself was the highest inflation recorded since February 2019. BSP's forecast range is also higher than the 2.9% recorded in January last year. Price increases for fuel, meat, and power, as well as higher excise taxes on alcoholic drinks and tobacco, are expected to drive the uptick. But the central bank adds these could be offset by lower rice, fish, and vegetable prices, as well as the continued appreciation of the peso.
Philippine Labor Secretary Silvestre Bello III warns of possible business closures and more layoffs if his agency will endorse a wage hike. Bello says being employed is more important right now instead of getting a salary increase. He adds if a wage hike will be approved, some employers will be forced to close the shop and it may particularly hurt micro, small and medium enterprises. The highest minimum wage in the country is in Metro Manila at 500 to 537 pesos. Calls for a wage hike are mounting as prices of basic goods continue to rise.
Some 8.8% of global working hours were lost in 2020 due to the pandemic. That's according to the International Labor Organization. The losses were equivalent to 255 million full-time jobs and an unprecedented 114 million workers joining the ranks of the unemployed. ILO data show women and younger workers were most affected, while the hardest hit sectors were accommodations, food services, retail, and manufacturing. The ILO predicts more working hours will be lost this year and possibly in 2022.
What I think is particularly concerning is that the great majority of this loss of employment, 71%, and that is the equivalent of 81 million people, has translated into labor market inactivity. These people have simply dropped out of the labor market. Either they are unable to work, perhaps because of pandemic restrictions or social obligations, or they've given up looking for work. And so their talents, their skills, their energy have been lost.
The ILO says latest projections for 2021 show most countries will experience a relatively strong recovery in the second half of the year as vaccination programs take effect.
The U.S. economy contracted at its deepest pace since the Second World War. For 2020, U.S. GDP shrank 3.5%, its worst performance in 74 years. It's also the first annual economic contraction since the Great Recession. In the fourth quarter of 2020, the U.S. economy grew at a 4% annual rate. Though a rebound is underway, economists warn a sustained recovery will not take hold unless vaccines are distributed and administered nationwide. They also urged lawmakers to pass U.S. President Joe Biden's massive $1.9 trillion economic relief plan to help struggling businesses and individuals cope with the pandemic.
More to come. The U.S. reaffirms its support to Taiwan after China said independence for Taiwan means war.
And in sports, Filipino tennis player Alex Ayala advances to the quarterfinals of the ITF tournament. Stay with us.
You have to be a working manager and a leader at the same time.
Your team will only do as you do and not as you say. So it's very important to set the right example.
People who are in the leadership sector should be able to walk the talk. You cannot preach about sustainability without making sacrifices, small sacrifices in your lifestyle. That's the key. It will redound to the individual behavior of the people preaching and of the people actually following.
Authentic community. By focusing on that particular core value, a lot of these Gen Zs and millennials can be themselves. They don't have to pretend anymore. As we prioritize the voices and the feedback of our young.
To watching Topsoy. Let's now check on the weather here in the Philippines with PAGASA forecaster Raymond Ordinario. Raymond.
Yes, Ron, good afternoon. And this is our forecast for the next 24 hours. It's still the northeast monsoon affecting the entire Luzon, bringing cloudy skies with rains over Cagayan Valley, Cordillera, Bicol region, Aurora, and Quezon. Meanwhile, in Visayas, there's also a cloudy skies with scattered rain showers. Here in Metro Manila and the rest of Luzon, we're going to expect a generally fair weather condition aside from some isolated light rains. While in Mindanao, we're going to expect also a generally fair weather condition aside from some isolated rain showers or thunderstorms. The temperature here in Metro Manila will range from 22 to 29 degrees Celsius, and in Baguio City is around 12 to 21 degrees Celsius. And Ron, because of the surge of the northeast monsoon, we have a gale warning raised over the seabirds of Batanes, Cagayan, Babuyan Island, Isabela, Aurora, Camarines Provinces, Catanduanes, the eastern coast of Albay, the eastern coast of Torsogon, and the eastern coast of Quezon, including the Polillo Island. Also raised over Ilocos Norte, Ilocos Sur, La Union, Pangasinan, Zambales, Bataan, the northern and eastern coast of Northern Samar, and the eastern coast of Eastern Samar, including the Homonhon Island. So we're still advising our fisher folks and those who have small sea craft not to venture out of those seabirds because we're still expecting some big waves that may reach up to 6 meters. Here in Metro Manila, the sun will set around 6:25 this afternoon. And in the next 3 days, we do not expect any tropical cyclone development or any tropical cyclone that might enter our Philippine area of responsibility. And that's the latest from the PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. This is Raymond Ordinario reporting.
Raymond, thanks for that.
More world news. The U.S. reaffirms its long-standing support to Taiwan amid rising tensions between the self-ruled island and China. Beijing's defense ministry on Thursday toughened its language towards Taiwan, warning that attempts to seek independence means war. The Pentagon says there was no reason that tensions need to lead to anything like confrontation.
We find that comment unfortunate and certainly not commensurate with our intentions to meet our obligations under the Taiwan Relations Act and to continue to, as Secretary Blinken at the State Department said yesterday, look for ways where we can cooperate with China. But we have obligations that we intend to meet.
China recently stepped up military activities near Taiwan, saying its armed forces were acting in response to provocation and foreign interference. Washington had urged Beijing to stop pressuring Taiwan after the island reported multiple Chinese fighter jets and bombers entering its air defense identification zone.
In sports, the Houston Rockets are starting to look good in their post-James Harden era. Victor Oladipo, who came in the Harden blockbuster deal, scored 25 points to lead the Rockets, who will come from behind 104-101 win against the Portland Trailblazers. The Rockets got off to a shaky start, trailing by as much as 20 points. But Oladipo, John Wall, and Christian Wood led a strong Houston surge in the second and third quarters to take control. It's now four straight wins for the Rockets.
Filipina tennis sensation Alex Ayala continued her hot streak in Spain as she eases past Alba Carillo Marin in the second leg of the ITF Rafael Nadal Academy World Tennis Tour. Ayala took the match in two sets, 6-2, 6-3. She advances to the quarterfinals, where she will meet Sweden's Elena Inalbon. Ayala is looking to clinch her second pro title after winning her first a few days back.
African-American actress Cicely Tyson, known for portraying strong black women in film, television and theater, has passed away. She was 96. No cause of death has been released yet. Tyson's most lauded performances came in historical works, among them the 1972 movie Sounder, for playing a Louisiana sharecropper's wife. Tyson became one of the first black actors to appear regularly on U.S. television, playing as George Scott's secretary on the series East Side, West Side. In her entire 60-year career, Tyson received three Emmys, a Tony Award, and an honorary Oscar. Days before her death, Tyson released her memoir titled Just As I Am.
Period drama Bridgerton is now Netflix's most popular series, garnering more than 82 million views in just 28 days. The streaming platform announced the show reached number one in 83 countries, including the U.S., Britain, Brazil, France, India, and South Africa. The period drama beat fantasy action series The Witcher, which got 76 million views in just 1 month. The drama, set in the early 1800s, centers on the wealthy Bridgerton family as it tries to navigate Regency-era high society in England. It has been praised for casting black actors in period drama roles that are traditionally played by white actors.
Remember the viral photo of U.S. Senator Bernie Sanders wearing mittens at U.S. President Joe Biden's inauguration? Well, it has become more than just a meme now, raising $1.8 million U.S. dollars for charity. Sanders announced he was able to raise that much money by making shirts inspired by the meme. Sanders will distribute the money to several charities in his home state of Vermont. His photo sitting cross-legged in woolly mittens became an instant sensation on the internet. Other people also dropped merchandise inspired by Sanders, like the Bernie doll, which raised $40,000 for charity.
Amanda Gorman, the young American poet who stole the spotlight at U.S. President Joe Biden's inauguration, will become the first poet to perform at the Super Bowl. Gorman will recite an original poem that will highlight three individuals who served as leaders in their communities during the pandemic. She says she is humbled as poetry is now being brought at the forefront of the most watched television broadcast in the U.S. The recitation will be featured at Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida, and it will air nationally. The 22-year-old National Youth Poet Laureate reveals she was in talks with the Super Bowl way before she was invited to Biden's inauguration. And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Densai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.